Okay, our next presentation looks at how our physical world and the digital worlds are converging through the use of new technologies such as augmented reality, 3D printing, and the Internet of Things. Here to explain more and to boldly walk the walk with a live and interactive demo is Brian Thompson from PTC.
Got to lay this down here to make this work right. While we're getting set up, if you don't have ThingWorks View on your mobile device, I recommend you download it. We're going to have an opportunity for you to experience a CAD design in augmented reality right here in the session. I tried it yesterday from way up there, and it actually worked with my iPhone, so it was pretty cool. You're going to have like a skill saw, you know, about the size of the whole center section of the audience, maybe, if you're in the audience. So while we're getting set up, maybe you could try to download that. Okay, so a little bit of interaction and live demo, operating without a net here. I do have videos to back up. We'll see how it goes. Thanks for the opportunity. It's great to be here. This is my second year in a row, third year in a row PTC has been able to come here and present for you all. And we're going to talk a little bit about how new technologies are bringing the digital designs that all of you create closer to the physical products that that you're putting out in the field, okay? And it starts with this notion that this physical and digital convergence is actually driving quite a bit of opportunity in businesses. I'm talking to a lot of customers that have sort of a smart connected product strategy in the marketplace, and they're seeing a lot of potential value. And this potential value is really around three technologies that are bridging the gap between the physical and the digital worlds, okay? So one technology that I'm sure you've all heard a lot about is IoT, okay? This is technology that's allowing our customers to learn more about what's happening with their products on a real-time basis as their products behave in the field and bring that information back into the enterprise. There's some different uses of that information, and I'm going to make it real for you, hopefully, as engineers. We'll give you an opportunity to see what that really means. 3D printing is another really, really important boundary crossing technology. I'm pretty sure you can't throw a rock in this place and not hit a 3D printing vendor or someone talking about 3D printing. There's a lot of 3D printing talk here at the event, and we've got some pretty cool stuff we're working on there as well. I know I'm not alone in that respect. You've heard a lot about that this morning already. But the notion that you can take a digital design and immediately have a production part in 3D pretty much directly from a 3D printer. It is pretty amazing. And the fact that customers are doing that now more and more in production is putting a lot of pressure on the engineering process, right? The engineering tools have to be able to support 3D printing a lot better in order for you to fully integrate a true design process for 3D printing into your product. Okay. Augmented and virtual reality. So this is the live demo, you know, audience interactive part of the presentation. Last year we had a bike on the stage. We did some augmented reality on that. I now just have a thing mark. We're gonna do a car on the stage. Okay. I didn't bring a car. Couldn't put a car on the stage. But we're gonna do a car. Okay. So we're gonna do that. We'll show you a little bit about what that could mean for engineering as well. All right. So you're not gonna do a car. I'm gonna do a car. You're gonna do a saw. All right, so that's how this is going to work. Hopefully you'll find that interesting. This is another great technology, right? I mean, being able to bring digital information to the physical product to enhance any kind of sort of repair or maybe manufacturing operation process is really valuable. And then maybe being able to experience what's happening with your product when you can't be there, sort of a full virtual reality experience for your designs, that's also an interesting possibility. And we'll take a look at some of those technologies and what's going on there. All right, now I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that, you know, IoT and augmented reality, these are big ideas that are having impacts all over the place. Smart manufacturing, Industry 4.0, this is a big trend, and there's quite a bit of value for just application of IoT and digital technologies all the way out into the manufacturing floor. You're seeing a lot of that from a lot of the vendors here. It's a big setting for IoT and VR, right? But we're a bunch of engineers. We're going to talk more about engineering. Other works, other places like smart cities, fields, work sites, Certainly the connected service use case for augmented reality and virtual reality is a big use case, but again, we're gonna talk about engineering. I had a bike last year, did a service operation on that bike with augmented reality, just kind of like what you're seeing here. In fact, I think you can see a demo just like this at our booth. I'm an engineer, you guys are all engineers. In fact, I spent about twice as much time actually in engineering in my career than I have at PTC. What we're going to do is talk a little bit more about the impact of some of these technologies, these boundary crossing technologies, IoT, augmented and virtual reality, and 3D printing on smart connected product design. Okay, so we try to make it real for engineering use cases. Let's jump into that. Most customers that want to have a smart connected product story, they're starting with a product in the field that already has some amount of sensors on it. They want to get some value from the sensors that are in that product. And the value that they can get from those sensors is going to be limited, right? You bring that information into the manufacturing space, into the service operations of your company through platform technology like ThingWorks, and you do what you can with it. You get as much information as you want from it, as much information as you can. You drive as much value as you can, and most companies are realizing that the existing data streams I can get from my products that happen to be in the field already can only take me so far. And this is where all of you come in. What we're realizing quickly as we talk to companies that are trying to drive better value from designing smart connected products is that it takes designing the product from the beginning for connectivity with all the stakeholders involved to really drive the value you want to drive from that. The process that we're talking about is designing the product from the beginning to be smart and connected, actually driving that definition of the smart connected product through an IoT platform into your product design as it gets manufactured. So that way, all the stakeholders in the organization, the manufacturing stakeholders, service stakeholders, even you in engineering, so that everybody gets the value out of designing that smart connected product exactly the way they want. We're introducing this concept, we call it design for connectivity. I'll admit it's an attempt to sort of play off of what many of you learned in college, or maybe when you learned it when you were first being trained as an engineer at your first job, you learned things like design for injection molding, right? There are rules for how to design injection molded parts. There are rules for how to design sheet metal parts and so forth. This is a much more of an expanded concept, I'll admit, but it's a concept nonetheless that we're finding is valuable. Customers that are sitting down and strategically thinking about how to instrument their products are getting the most value from those products once they go into the field. They're unlocking new business opportunities and so forth, okay? So how are we helping? Well, you know we all own the world's leading IoT platform. We're gonna connect to Creo. It's as simple as that. We're starting out with the concept of sensors that are designed into the product that are immediately linkable to our IoT platform. They're understood semantically by our IoT platform, right? So you design a sensor into your product. The sensor could be something as simple as a point in the CAD model, could be a full 3D model of the sensor, and the sensor can be an input or an output. When you put sensors into the model, those sensors can be receivers of information or they could be transmitters of information back to the cloud. Okay, so the first process here that we're going to support is just this idea of designing the product from the beginning to have the right sensors in it, all the stakeholders involved, and so forth. But I'm hinting at some other value here, right? When you have data coming into your product connected to your digital design from the field, you can gain a lot of additional insights about what's happening with the product in the field. You can do additional calculations because you have a full fidelity 3D model of that design. Some things are going to be really difficult to measure. Some places it's difficult to put sensors. Some things can be measured indirectly. All of these things are possible when you have a full fidelity 3D model. So we're going to give you the opportunity to understand what's happening in the field with your product better by giving you a chance to simulate product behavior based upon real data from the field. And of course, that leads to better next generation designs, right? Collating that data, bringing it all together, and understanding just how well my original assumptions for my product design map to what's actually happening in the real world with my product, that overlay of those two sets of information, that could be really, really valuable for engineering to give engineers some confidence, maybe some ease of mind that they designed around the right requirements, or maybe it's some concern, right? They realize they have some issues. Either way, we want you to replace the original engineering assumptions that you had that drove your design with real product data feedback from the field and use that seamlessly in your product design by connecting your digital designs through ThingWorks to your products or to your product population. Okay? So this is Creo Product Insight. This is coming out very, very soon. It's coming out here in June, and we're pretty excited about it. It'll be a really, really nice native connection to, you know, an IoT platform that's already got millions of products connected to it, right? So it's a pretty exciting thing. I'm going to show you just a quick video. This is very rough. It's very early. It's the same throttle body. I'm going to start by pointing out that we actually have two derived sensor values here on the left, the area of the throttle body that's open and the distance that the throttle body is open. Both have to be sort of indirectly calculated from the geometry. And we have one input variable, the angle that the throttle body is open. And if the worst thing that happens to me today in my presentation is I lose the button on my coat, we're okay. Hopefully I don't lose any other buttons here today. All right, let me start this video and kind of explain what it is we're seeing and doing. Is this running? Yeah, okay. So first thing you'll notice is when you're designing a product from scratch for connectivity, you may not have any real data from the field yet to use. And of course, there are plenty of places where you can get simulated product performance data, and we're going to give you an easy way to incorporate that simulated product performance data directly into the design to see how the design reacts and recalculates and can push data back. So what you're seeing here is a simple flat file input, right? This is just basic, just getting started, getting a sense for how the model reacts to inputs to see how, you know, the additional insights that you want to gain will be realized in the CAD model. So that's what you saw there. We just calculated based upon a stream of data. You know, pretty interesting. It's just the start point. Now what we're going to do is we're going to transition into connecting to a very, very simple ThingWorks dashboard. Okay, there are, you know, hundreds of thousands of these dashboards all over the world monitoring products all over the world for PTC, but not any of them are connected to the digital design of the products yet. This is what you're going to see here, is we're going to connect through ThingWorks to maybe a throttle body. You could think of this throttle body as maybe it's under test, right, at the initial, maybe the initial release of the design. So we're going to connect to the design here, and we can show that if we set this thing to transmitting now we have a live connection between the CAD model and the ThingWorks display here. So when I set a value, it goes through and it calculates and it returns some values. So this is a CAD model that's actually in the loop with what's happening with the product in the cloud, right? Because it took a value in, an angle, calculated some results, and sent that result, those results back to ThingWorks, and they're redisplayed back here in this simple display of the data, right? Very, very easy to go back and forth, no problem. But we can take it, you know, a bit further. You know, ThingWorks has nice tools for rapid application development. We can do things like build a dashboard. Most of you know that Creo has an embedded browser inside it, and so we can build a ThingWorks dashboard in this embedded browser showing this same information, but showing it in a little bit richer way, right? So we'll come to a ThingWorks dashboard here. So now what we'll be able to see in this ThingWorks dashboard is the live angle information, and then you're starting to see some historical data on the derived values, the calculated open area, and the calculated distance that the throttle body is open. So now you're starting to get a sense that, you know, this kind of integration can be a time machine. You can go back into time, see what was going on with the product, get better context about what was going on by performing this calculation with the CAD model in the loop, and actually get a real sense for any kind of anomalies you might have seen or other problems you're having with the product, okay? So last but not least, we can simulate a live connection to a real product under test and actually have the CAD model running through a calculation here. Boom, 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 right? Connected live to the ThingWorks platform, okay? Some calculations won't happen that fast. This could be any kind of calculation. This could be a finite element analysis, thermal analysis, even a nonlinear plastic deformation analysis. These would not happen real time, right? But they could still be really valuable and provide additional context in terms of what was happening with your product in the field. You can go back at any time, pinpoint a point of time, say, give me that data, let me drive it into my CAD environment and do this with a live connection, okay? So that's a sort of an initial start at thinking about designing for connectivity and what, you know, connecting your CAD environment to ThingWorks, to your products in the field, through ThingWorks, I should say, could mean to you. All right, so that's our first boundary crossing technology, added to IoT. Let me talk about added manufacturing next. I was here last year. We talked about all the value that people are, I don't have to convince anybody in the room that additive manufacturing is really important. It's just kind of interesting to see a segment of the manufacturing industry growing at strong double-digit CAGR when the general manufacturing marketplace in the world is growing at low single digits, right? It's a very, very strong growth area. And it's because there's tremendous value. And frankly, it's because there's tremendous value to using additive manufacturing in production. But there's a problem with that. And that is that design processes are still catching up, okay? Design processes today end up starting with a design environment to take advantage of the full capabilities that 3D printers can provide. You use some separate piece of software for optimization that creates, you know, a derivative version of the model, or a version of the model that's a completely separate part, or a version of the model that's got mixed geometry, what have you. Either way, it's got something in it that's not exact that most of my customers would not want to release to production. It's got some tessellated elements in it that you can't measure directly, you can't rely on their accuracy, and if you're lucky, when you get that optimized shape, it actually can be printed on the printer you're targeting, right? You might even have to go back and make some changes to make sure you're following the rules of printing on that 3D printer. So what do most customers do? What they do is they rebuild the model that's been optimized and hope that when they reanalyze it, that it actually meets the requirements of the original optimized shape. Then they re-3D print check it, and then they hope that it's ready to go for production. Okay, this is a broken process. And by the way, it's not all that different from the process that we had 10, 15 years ago with CAM software and CAD. All the CAM vendors said, our software for integrating with our tool is unique. We're not going to allow the CAD vendors to integrate with it. And what happened? The design community charged ahead and said, no, we have to integrate that stuff into the CAD environment. Same thing's going to happen here, and it is happening, right? We have to bring everything down into a single environment where you don't have four different pieces of software and three different disconnected copies of the model with all different types of geometry, all separated out and hard to keep track of with a completely broken design process. We just can't have this. And I don't think I'm alone in the room with other vendors here saying this has got to be fixed. And our commitment to our customers is to say any 3D printing ready technology will be integrated directly into the CAD environment. Nothing will ever be broken. We won't put it in unless it's ready, unless it doesn't break your design process. And when I was here a year ago, we said, we're not experts. We're still not experts. We're getting better. We're learning more and more about 3D printing. But we do have a growing list of partnerships. Last year, I only had Stratasys on this screen. This year, we now have 3D Systems. We have iMaterialize. And coming soon, we actually have the Materialized drivers that are going to be supported in Creo. This represents a very, very big proportion of the overall 3D printing market, particularly for production printing. So from within Creo, design, optimize to take advantage of what 3D printing can do for you. Check whether or not that part design can be printed on the 3D printer you're targeting, so that with confidence when you print it directly or your operations team decides to print it, they can print it and it'll work. Okay? So that's the strategy. Let's take a look at what exactly we've done. Last year I showed a pretty cool use case of some 2.5D structures. These are not tessellated lattices. These are real BREP lattices. This is not a derivative of your model. This is your actual design model with real BREP lattices. No approximation. Every piece of geometry is exact right there in the CAD model. Okay? All these different varieties of lattices fully parameterized so that the parameters can be used in optimizations. We did exactly the same thing in 3D. Bunch of different types of lattice structures. You see them down here. Hexes, octagons, squares, so forth, right? Again, fully parameterized so that those parameters can be used in optimizations. Real geometry, not an approximation. Measurable, inspectable, the whole deal, right? Right there in your CAD model. Not a derivative part concept here at all. Last year, I showed a very, very simple optimization. We started with a very simple bracket. We did kind of a very simple 2.5D lattice, took a lot of weight out of it. We did arrive at this automatically, But as we went through the last year of development, we realized we can do so much more with this technology. It's pretty amazing. What I'm going to talk about here is kind of the concept of engineering product performance into the design using this technology and using optimization capabilities built into the Creo platform. Just a very simple use case. If you're an engineer, you've analyzed a million beams, you're probably sick of it. But this is a very, very special beam. We have a certain set of loads that we've got to maintain. Imagine your requirements are a certain amount of deflection in one direction, a certain amount of deflection in another direction. You got to avoid certain resonant frequencies. And oh, by the way, you'd like to reduce the weight. Wouldn't it be nice to put all of this into a tool and say, let's keep the outside shape, because I don't always have the flexibility to change the outside shape in certain design situations, and find me something that meets a set of requirements like this. Well, we did that example. And what you see here is a variable three-dimensional lattice structure that was calculated automatically by our optimization engine to meet a bunch of requirements just like that, okay? It's a multivariable optimization study. Super powerful stuff. That's a quick look at the simplified lattice structure inside that we use to analyze it. And by the way, this design process is not all that different from designing a motorcycle bike swing arm. You don't have complete flexibility into how this is designed from terms of shape, but you do want to drive at kind of the similar set of requirements. Maximum load, max deflection, certain resonant frequencies on the bike, reduce the weight, same kind of thing. This is a 12-part assembly that could be done as a single part now. In the 3D printer, there it is again, a variable lattice structure. Okay, so this is what we mean by engineering product performance. None of this ever requires you to leave the CAD environment or create a derivative copy of your CAD model. You're doing it right there in the CAD design. So let me show, by the way, you should remember this, remember I said I was going to have a car on stage? Remember this car. You're going to see it again in augmented reality. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to combine some IoT technology that I showed you earlier with the 3D printing stuff to do some pretty cool stuff. This is the front suspension on that car. That's an electric car built by a company called Ego. They were kind enough to share the models with us, and ran the car through some suspension testing. We collected that data live using our IoT integration, and we're going to use that to drive some simulations of this wishbone part in the front. We're going to calculate reaction forces there as the suspension travels up and down. Pretty cool looking. Those of you that are familiar with our simulation capabilities know that you can take the dynamic analysis results you get there, and you can use them directly in a structural simulation, right? This is exactly what you should be able to do. We've got the connection to the simulation tools. But what we're going to do here is we're going to sort of set a baseline for the structural analysis in Creo, and then we'll use some lattice technology to optimize it while retaining the shape of the part. Okay, so there's the baseline analysis. Then what we'll do is we'll add one of the three-dimensional lattices to the interior volume of the part. I think we use the hex in this case. If you look closely on this pullout panel, these are all the variables associated with the hex lattice that you can optimize on based upon our optimization engine. But that is a constant, pretty chunky lattice model that takes some of the weight out and still more than adequately satisfies the other constraints of the mechanical design. But now what we're going to do is take that lattice and say, let's go find an optimal design that actually achieves the structural requirements of the design while minimizing weight. And we'll use all of the variables that the lattice structure has available to it as part of its definition to drive this simulation. Again, never leaving the Creo environment, right? So when we do that and run this optimization, I'm a little ahead of the video here. Here we go, okay? You get this result. Remarkably different than the interior, and if you look closely, you realize the result is variable. It's not a constant lattice structure. The lattice is variable. It's thicker and denser where it needs to be to carry more load, and less thick and less dense where it doesn't need to be to carry less. So we've pulled as much weight as possible out as we can. In fact, we've almost cut the weight down in half. All real geometry, never leaving the CAD environment, okay? 42% weight reduction. So pretty cool. We're very excited about this. All this stuff that you're just seeing here is all released and available in the product today. We were sort of previewing it last time I was here, and I'm happy to say we finally shipped that. But whenever I talk about this stuff, I always get asked about topology optimization. Brian, what about topology optimization? When are you going to do something with topology optimization? I said, hold on. Our commitment is to do it in the design environment, right? We don't want anybody having to break the design process, deal with tessellated geometry so that they have difficulty inspecting it, they have difficulty getting their manufacturing teams to sign off on it. We're working on it. What you're going to see next is a preview. Okay, this is not in Creo 4. Okay, this is a look into the future. But it's very, very cool. The first part of this is really you're seeing this from all of us here. It's standard topology optimization capabilities. You know, you have keep out zones that you want to keep analytic. You have loads. You have the boundary conditions, the whole deal. You want to minimize the weight, achieve a particular goal. All that's pretty standard topology optimization stuff. Most of the time, it's done in some secondary piece of technology that breaks the design process. There's a mesh. We're going to get an optimization here. Okay, let me pause this. I don't know any customers of mine that want to release that model to production. It's pretty ugly, right? It's not all that unusual for what comes out of topology optimization engines, and I could have set the results to be finer, of course, right? Could have done that. I did this way to make a point. That's not a model you're going to release to production. You notice that stuff that was supposed to stay cylindrical did stay cylindrical. That all works. That's great. But you want real geometry out of this. So this is not a mouse. This is a mouse. What we really want to do, and this is not how the workflow would work. You're going to get this automatically, but I'm letting you peer into the PTC's future here in CAD. We're going to create geometry automatically from that. That is real BREP geometry. That's freestyle. If you're not familiar with freestyle, it's basically subdivisional surfaces, okay? If you're familiar with the way we did subdivisional surfaces, it's completely integrated in the CAD environment. It ships with every seat of Creo. It's editable. It's constrainable. You can constrain it to curves. You can constrain it to surfaces. So if you want to go back in and control certain aspects of it, very, very easy to do. This is the real deal. This is real geometry. We're automatically calculating that on top of the topology optimized result so that you don't break the design process, okay? Now this has been a lot of smart mathematicians working on this for a while. That's why we're, you know, whenever I get asked, I say, we're working on it, but I'm committed to include it in the product only when we can include it in a way that doesn't break the design process, okay? So that's why you're seeing this now. I hope to be here a year from now showing you this live in the product shipped. That's the goal, right? You guys all know software engineering isn't an exact science, but I hope to be here live showing this next year. This is really exciting for us. I'm pretty pumped about it. All right, now we're to the audience participation part of the show, okay? CAD and augmented reality. You know, at its very base form for a design engineer, what we want to do is we want to give a design engineer the opportunity to experience his or her design at whatever scale they choose, whenever they want to, okay? Very, very simply integrated into the CAD environment. That's what our goal is here. We want to try to make sure you can do this anytime, okay? So instead of showing you a video of that, I'm going to attempt to do it live, right out of Creo, not with a motorbike, but with a very simple model, because I've been given some network access, and I'm going to try not to stretch it too far. Very simple port-a-cable saw, right? Good customer. Here's what you're going to be able to do. All right, so here's our CAD model. We use something called a thing mark. Think of it as an intelligent barcode. It gives you an opportunity to encode information about the experience directly in there and also give you a sense of scale for the model, okay? Everybody that has a PTC.com account, they're free, gets their own thing mark. And with that thing mark, you have the opportunity to carry around with you any number of experiences based upon that thing mark. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to publish this to the cloud. I was accused last year of not being very cloudy. Martin called me not very cloudy. Accused all of PTC not being very cloudy. Well, this is cloud. All right, this is a CAD model with just in triangles published to the cloud, okay? We're protecting your IP because no geometry goes up there. In fact, we stream the data from the cloud to the remote device. Okay, so your IP isn't moving around. It's staying in the CAD model. Triangles go up and triangles get streamed. Okay, so this takes about 20 seconds or so. I am crazy enough to do a live demo, but I'm not crazy enough to do it on Wi-Fi sharing with all of you. So I got my own connection here. And when we're done, what we're gonna do is I'll show you how we can share this. In fact, I already sent Martin Day an email. I don't know if he knows he got it. But I'll show you how we can share this. And if you have ThingWorks View on your phone, now's the time to get ready. If you have it in Google, if you have it in on Apple, get it ready, because we're gonna be able to sort of see this live if this finishes publishing. Okay? Operating without a net here. Do I have to check the browser to see if I have internet access? Oh, we do. Okay, beautiful. All right, great. So how would we share this, right? So I can come up here and say share thing mark. What it'll do is it'll kick off an email from me. You see my Outlook come up, and unfortunate enough to see my calendar, that would not be good. Okay, here we go. Here's an email. So we send the thing mark out. We give your colleague, your friend, your customer an opportunity to know exactly where to go to find ThingWorks View. It's free of charge. Here's what the ThingMark looks like. Okay? This'll work. If you use ThingWorks View to try to scan that, this'll work. I'll scan it with this iPad. See if you can see what I see. Let's see, can we switch over to Apple Play? Oh, beautiful. All right. So I'm just gonna scan it right here on the screen. If I don't cover the, there it is. You see that? Now, is anybody doing this from the audience? I'm gonna make it massively huge. Pretty good fidelity. Does anybody have it? It takes a little while to download an LTE. I can make it kind of see-through, right? I could spin it around. I could also spin it around a little bit here. Okay, this is at whatever scale you choose. Little bit of augmented reality. And by the way, the detail's in there. I can kind of come in and, whoa. There we are, look at the gears and stuff. It's all there, all right? So you can imagine, at any time during the design process, sharing a status of this design with anybody at any time, at any scale, right, directly from Creo, all protecting your intellectual property, because it's all nothing but triangles, okay? Just stream from the cloud. But we can take this a lot further. In fact, we're still up. Okay, so this is the big finish. This is the design review app. You can imagine applications built around this technology that not only help you experience what's going on, but also help you grab information from your enterprise systems, what's going on in the product. So let me scan this thing, Mark. This ought to be, oh, I gotta go back to, there we go. Oh boy, what's the password? I don't think I need the password. Ah, beautiful, okay. So now there's a lot more triangles streaming down here. And this time I am on Wi-Fi, as you can see. So just cut me a little bit of slack on that. I'm gonna try to turn the chassis on. And what you're gonna see is the full Ego car chassis here on the stage, okay? It's lightweight. I don't need it, I didn't need to roll it out on the stage, get all sorts of approvals. Here we go, there she is. That's the same chassis, right? Remember that? Now, this is a little cumbersome when I'm, oh, Siri, I don't wanna talk to you. Oh boy. See, this is proof, it's a live demo. There we go. All right, just had to reconnect. I'm gonna try not to press the button again. HoloLens support is coming in June. If you're wearing a HoloLens, totally different scenario, right? Your hands are free, you can walk around it. But this is a pretty interesting opportunity to do design review, because there's more to this concept than you might think. Because this is based upon ThingWorks technology, and ThingWorks can access information from all your enterprise systems, I can look at things like, what were the requirements driving this car design? What's the bill of material look like? What are some of the detailed drawings, right? I can also maybe interact with a couple different options for body style. We'll see which one you guys like the most. There's the blue body. No one likes that one? What do you think? I like this one the best. The third choice I like the best. That's kind of cool looking, right? Pretty neat. All the surfacing done in Creo, by the way. You can overlay them if you want. Well, at least I think you can. Yeah, there you go. So now you can kind of see subtle places where the two body styles overlap. See the blue and the gray overlaid on one another? Okay? Now, this is an app built on Vuforia View. It does a lot more than what I showed you, right? Everybody's going to get what I showed first. Publish your model to the cloud, stream graphics down. This is an app that's connecting into enterprise systems, giving you multiple versions of the CAD to design and evaluate as part of your design review at any time. This is just where you can go with this technology, starting with what I showed you with CAD. All right? So I'm actually fairly shocked that all worked. It's awesome. So I want to thank, I wish to really thank Martin and the team for all their support. It was pretty amazing getting all that working in a short amount of time. You know, coming here, getting on the Wi-Fi, getting on the network. Really excited that all worked out. I had backup videos just in case the bottom fell out of this, but didn't need to use them. So that's the end of my talk. I hope you got a chance to see how IoT, 3D printing, augmented and virtual reality, they are true boundary-crossing technologies that are helping take engineering a lot further and guiding a lot of the investments we're making in the CAD strategy. Thanks so much for your time, and I'll look forward to seeing you all on the floor.